Based on the germinal layer, animals can be categorized as diploblastic and triploblastic. You know what is diplo, triploblastic? In the 10th class, we have studied about the zygote formation, you know, the blastocyst, the gastrula. Then we talk about germ layer formation. So during the embryonic development, early embryo develop into gastrula, and gastrula with two germinal layer, or gastrula with three germinal layers. And what is that? If we talk about two germinal layers, that is ectoderm and endoderm. And if we talk about animals with three germinal layer, and that germinal layer is ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. And we know that our body organs develop from these germinal layers only. Few organs develop from ectoderm, few from meso, and few from endoderms. So basically, these germinal layers develop into different kind of tissues and organs. Now, if we talk about the basic categorization of diploblastic and triploblastic animals, so basically, in the porifera, where tissues system is lacking, so according to the some scientist, poriferans can be considered as primitive diploblastic, but as per the lack of tissue system, they can't be categorized as true diploblastic or triploblastic animals. So basically, by the classification system, poriferans can be considered as primitive diploblastic. Remember, porifera, the file number 1, can be considered as primitive diploblastic animal. Second and third phylum are considered as true diploblastic animals, and from the 4 to 11 they all are considered as a true diploblastic animals. So remember, depending upon the germ layer, poriferans are called primitive diploblastic, but they are not true diploblastic animals. True diploblastic animals are only second, third phylum, that is Coelenterata and Ctenophora, and after that all the phylums are categorized under triploblastic animals, starting from Platyhelminthes to Chordata. So remember that term, diploblastic and triploblastic animals. Now, after the characterization of animals on the basis of diploblastic and triploblastic animals, now the Eumetazoa group, that is a very big group containing 10 phylum, that Eumetazoa can be further classified or grouped into two different kind of taxa, we can say, on the basis of body symmetry, and they are called Radiata and Bilateria. So now we will discuss about the classification of animals depending upon their symmetry. So basically we can see like this, phylums can be grouped as 1, 2, 3, and 4 to 11 on the basis of their symmetry. Like poriferans are mostly asymmetrical because they don't have definite shape and size. Poriferans are supposed to be mostly asymmetrical. Remember the term mostly asymmetrical. They are called mostly asymmetrical. They don't have definite kind of symmetry. The second, third phylum belongs to the taxa called Radiata, and the 4 to 11 phylum belongs to the group Bilateria. What is that? Radiata means animals with radial symmetry, animals with radial symmetry. And Bilateria means animals with bilateral symmetry. Remember the term Radiata and Bilateria, animals with radial symmetry and animals with bilateral symmetry. Now what is that radial symmetry? Just look at diagram. Suppose there is a structure like this, and we need to cut that kind of structure into two identical half, completely identical half, and these halves must be mirror image of each other. That's clear. So suppose this is the central point of that organisms. So we can make a cut like this. We can make a cut like this. We can make a cut like this. That every point that is passing through the center. So there can be a several axis. You know, there can be several axis which can divide the body into two equal halves, and these equal halves must be mirror image of each other. So if there is a possibility of more than one axis to cut the body into two identical halves, and these halves must be mirror image of each other, that kind of symmetry is called radial symmetry. Remember, this is called radial symmetry. And if suppose this is the structure of human beings, and if you need to cut such a structure into two identical halves, two almost identical halves, that halves cannot be mirror image of each other, there will be a single axis like this, only one single axis that will divide the body into two equal halves, not exactly two equal halves, but almost two equal halves. And that kind of axis is called, this is called mid sagittal axis. This is called mid sagittal axis. That mid sagittal axis will divide the body into almost two equal halves. And remember, this is the only one possible axis that can divide the body into two, almost two equal halves. So if only one axis is there, one axis is possible to cut the body, such kind of symmetry is called bilateral symmetry. Remember the term bilateral symmetry. And remember, only those animals having bilateral symmetry, we can talk about the different planes like dorsal ventral axis, the right and left half. Because if we have a spherical mass, let us suppose this is the structure like this, and how can we classify where left and right of such a structure, where anterior posterior part of that structure, where is dorsal, where is ventral part of that structure? Yes, but if you need to cut that structure into two equal halves, we can make several axes like this, and every axis will cut the body into two equal halves. So if the animal is like this, or animal shape is like this, so they must have a kind of radial symmetry. But we have a structure like this, we can divide the body into two almost equal half by a single axis, and that axis is called mid sagittal axis. So the term left right, the term dorsal ventral, the term anterior posterior, all kind of characteristic is applicable only in those organisms that bears bilateral symmetry. So bilateria with bilateral symmetry, and radiata with radial symmetry. That's clear. And remember, in radially symmetrical animals, we talk about the term oral and aboral surface. Oral and aboral surface. The site of entry of food, that is called oral surface, and behind the oral part is called aboral part. But like the term anterior posterior, dorsal ventral, and left right, such kind of terms is applicable only for bilaterally symmetrical animals. That's clear. And in bilaterally symmetrical animals, one advantage is that, you know, how can we relate the appearance of symmetry in different animals, as per their evolutionary significance. Like initially animals were sessile or sedentary. They were not very much active. They were mostly sessile or sedentary mode. Means they are attached with the surface. They are not showing active movement. So those organisms that were initially, sedentary or sessile, they developed radial symmetry. And once the animal started directional movement, they developed bilateral symmetry. So bilateral symmetry is associated with the directional movement, whereas radial symmetry is associated with the sessile or sedentary mode of life. That's clear. Now if we talk about the example of radiata and example of bilateria, radiata includes the two phylum, that is Cylindrata and Ctenophora, and from the Platyhelminthes to Chordata, the symmetry is called bilateral symmetry, and the group is called bilateria. But remember a few points here, like one phylum is called Echinodermata. The phylum number 9 is called Echinoderms. The phylum number 9, Echinoderms, Echinoderms, if we talk about their larva and their adult structure, remember, larva is very much active. Larva has active mode of life. So the larval symmetry is bilateral. Larva is bilateral, but adult develop radial symmetry. So we can say animals with dual symmetry, and that kind of symmetry is present in echinoderms. Larva with bilateral symmetry and the adult with radial symmetry. That's clear. But remember, if you talk about the group of echinoderms, echinoderms always belongs to the group bilateria. Whatever their symmetry is, it hardly matters. The group is bilateria. Symmetry is both, both kind of symmetry is present in echinoderms, but the group is always bilateria. And remember, radiata are diploblastic. Radiata must be diploblastic, but bilateria are all triploblastic. So if one says all bilateria have bilateral symmetry, it's a wrong statement. All bilateria have bilateral symmetry, it's a wrong statement, because echinoderms also belongs to bilateria, but they are adult having radial symmetry. So that kind of statement is wrong. All bilateria have bilateral symmetry, it's a wrong statement. If someone says all bilateria are triploblastic, that is true. All radiata have radial symmetry, or biradial symmetry, that is true. But if someone says all radiata are all radiata have diploblastic conditions, that is also true, but that is not correct for bilateria. If someone says all bilateria have bilateral symmetry, it becomes wrong. Or if someone says all radially symmetrical animals must be radiata, it is also wrong, because larva is bilateral, but they are triploblastic. Adult have radial symmetry, but they are triploblastic. So if someone says all radially symmetrical animals are radiata, it is also a wrong statement. That's clear. So that is all about the part of symmetry. What is radiata, what is bilateria, and how we classify, how we group the phylum in these category. That's good. Now, further classification is best on the basis of their body cavity or coelomic cavity. Now, because radiata is a very small group of phylum, we don't need to classify the group radiata, but we need to classify bilateria, because that is a bigger group, into different kind of we can say bilateria can be further classified into different group of animals depending upon their body cavity or coelom. So now we will discuss about coelomic cavity.